this gaming laptop has a mobile RTX 3050 in it, which is like a slightly cut down version of Nvidia's little boba RTX graphics card that they stuffed in a laptop. And considering that we had a look at how the desktop RTX 3050 handles ray tracing, I thought it would be fun to see how the mobile RTX 3050 handles getting its teeth kicked in by ray tracing. If you compare the specs of a desktop RTX 3050 to its mobile brethren, the difference is not insignificant. I'm no expert, but those numbers are definitely smaller. The mobile version even has fewer tensor cores and ray tracing cores, which is Nvidia's dedicated ray tracing hardware. And that's not to mention the thermal limitations of stuffing a graphics card into what's basically a keyboard with a screen glued to it. Now, the reason that I draw this comparison is to show that the mobile RTX 3050 is the least powerful RTX graphics card by some margin. And to complicate things further, there are several different power draw versions of the mobile RTX 3050. But luckily, the Asus Strix laptop that we're going to use for today's video has the most powerful 80 watt version. And that paired with the Ryzen 5 5600H and 16 gigs of RAM and dual channel means at least we're giving the mobile RTX 3050 a fighting chance. And with that little bit of context, let's throw the baby mobile 3050 into the ray-traced alley knife battle. I think Quake 2's RTX demo is a great first game for videos like this because there's such a clear difference when you turn ray tracing on. Here, with none of our rays being traced, you can see that it just looks like Quake 2, a 20 odd year old game, running at 700 frames per second. And then when we go into settings and we change the renderer to RTX, and that's made a massive difference. You can see that the lighting is all super realistic now, and there's like lights reflecting off of things. But at the same time, we have also lost more than 600 frames per second. But who needs frame rate when you've got reflections this sexy? But really, every time I run this, I'm so impressed with how much of a difference very realistic lighting can make to an old game like this. And I'm still disappointed that we don't see more old games remade with this technology, because it just breathes so much life back into them, you know? Like, if they made a ray-traced version of Morrowind or something like that, that would be really cool. But anyway, moving on. And this also just really illustrates how much of a performance hit ray tracing can have on a system. Now, with modern games, the difference is much less pronounced. So having said that, let's see how the little mobile 3050 deals with Battlefield 5. Now, with Battlefield 5 at 1080p high settings, it's running pretty well. It looks nice, it feels nice and stable. The little mobile RTX 3050 is also running its heart out. You can see core frequency-wise, it occasionally jumps to just about 90. Oh, yeah, we got 1900 megahertz there. So let's turn on DXR and see what happens. Well, I'll be damned. It's actually running at above 60 frames per second-ish. With DXR on high, with all of the other settings on high as well. They've clearly done some optimization to the ray tracing performance of Battlefield 5 since it's been out, because we're not getting that much of a performance hit anymore. It's down a reasonable bit, and I can't visually tell the difference between it on and off, but the performance hit isn't quite that bad. Although it does very much depend on the scene, like when there's a bunch of fire and smoke and stuff, it does dip into the mid 30s, which is not ideal for online PvP. But still, it's kind of running it, which is impressive. Now here, we're running control at 1080p high settings, and I actually already had to turn anti-aliasing off because that just straight headbutt the laptop's performance in the face even before we turned ray tracing on. But anyway, like this, it's running fine. You know, it's a visual safari game. You don't need super high frame rates. But let's see what happens when we start tracing them rays. So I'm just gonna say hi, all of it. There we go. It's definitely running slower, but I'm surprised at how small of a performance impact there actually was. But I don't know, does it look any better? You know, you like run in here with the marble floors and the lighting and you're like, wow, there's reflections and stuff. It looks really good. But if you go into the settings and you turn ray tracing off, the reflections are still there. Now, they're definitely not quite as convincing as the reflections were with ray tracing on, but they still look pretty good, you know? Like, they're decent reflections. But anyway, that's not the point of this video. Let's try another game. Minecraft is another one of those games where visually ray tracing makes a very big difference. Here with it off, the frame rate's pegged at 120 FPS. It would be much higher with the frame rate uncapped, but this is Bedrock Minecraft and I'm a boomer, so I couldn't figure out how to uncap the frame rate. But anyway, let's turn ray tracing off and see what it does. So you just do that. 12 render chunks. It's actually giving us a warning here. Wow, we lost a lot of frame rate. It's all input laggy and molassesy now. This is not a very usable Minecraft gaming experience, but it does look all shiny, so that's very nice. I will play around with DLSS a bit later, my favorite RTX feature, but first, let's just try a couple more games. Now, Fortnite, at 1080p with competitive settings, which is everything low except draw distance is epic, it's running very well. Although, it is a bit more stuttery than I remember it being with DirectX 11. Let me know in the comment section down below if it's like a known problem that DX12 adds stutters to Fortnite. But with that, let's turn on ray tracing. Whoa, we've taken quite the hit, dropping from 200 down to 60 frames per second, but it's still running well. Like, this little mobile RTX 3050 has been handling ray tracing quite well. Let's play around with the settings a bit. The first thing I think we should do is just crank all of the ray tracing, which seems like a bit of a stupid thing to do considering that we have everything else on low. Oof, that's made a huge difference. This is about a tenth the performance we had before. After spending a while playing around with Fortnite settings, it became clear that ambient occlusion and reflections had by far the biggest performance penalty of all of the RT settings. So reflections, not even once, clearly, is the moral of the story here. It's finally time for everybody's favorite PC ball torture, Cyberpunk 2077. This is running at 1080p medium settings, medium preset. It's actually not running quite as well as I was expecting it to run, in all honesty, even without ray tracing on. But, again, it's usable. Let's start off with things on medium setting ray tracing. 7 frames per second. No, never mind, it's jumped up to 10 now, so that is a lot better. Let's try and get it to handle ray tracing. Medium ray tracing, which is the lowest ray tracing setting for some reason. So in terms of the most basic ray tracing setting possible for Cyberpunk, it's still not usable, but we've almost hit that cinematic frame rate of 24 frames per second. Psycho, straight up psycho, is it? Just gonna explode when we go out of the pause menu. Oh yes. There we go. This is peak gaming. Although it has jumped up to 7 frames per second. Not sure if this looks like 7 frames per second to me, but according to MSI Afterburner, we are getting 7 frames per second, which in all fairness is actually not as horrific as I was expecting it to run. And then, as I was about to turn on DLSS, I got distracted. Although, actually, no. First, let's try FidelityFX, which is like AMD's free DLSS. Let's start off with balanced and see how it compares. It's giving us almost 30 frames per second. It is quite blurry, though. You can really tell that it's on. Like, it's got a serious Vaseline effect. Especially like in the distance, anything that isn't right here gets very, very blurry. It looks like we're several glasses prescriptions behind. I then switched over to DLSS balanced and was surprised by the difference. We are also getting about 30 frames per second, although it looks a little better. I got about the same performance with FidelityFX 1.0 balanced and DLSS balanced, but in person, DLSS had a reasonable lead in terms of image quality. Although apparently, FidelityFX 2.0 is a big upgrade over 1.0. But at the end of the day, as is always the conclusion with these can it ray trace videos, DLSS is the most exciting part of the RTX technology suite. With both Cyberpunk and Fortnite, even with extremely demanding ray tracing settings, DLSS could make the game playable. And especially with Fortnite, it looked really good. You could barely tell it was on. Although, it's not always flawless. With Metro Exodus Enhanced Edition, DLSS added this weird smearing artifact. And with that, my main takeaway from this video was I need to play around with FidelityFX more. Let me know if you want to see some iGPU FidelityFX gaming action. And with that, thank you for watching. Until the next video, bye-bye.